coming again. To start, I'd just like to ask you, for the next 20 minutes or so, if we could just put ourselves in the shoes of consumers, think of ourselves as consumers. So what is it that you remember about the last 24 hours? Would you remember everything that you've been through in detail? If you ask me, frankly, I would not. Let me just show you a small slice of life video, and I do hope this works, given technology these days. Just a second. Lots of familiar places, lots of familiar brands. Does that look like what we go through these days? All fast-paced and running from one place to another? Now, given the fact that our lives are so busy, we have so much of sensory overload, so many stimuli that attack us from all directions, and given our dwindling attention spans, the 9 seconds is actually equal to the attention span of a goldfish. I'm not kidding you. The attention span of a goldfish is also 9 seconds. So given this kind of a background, it's no wonder that all consumers today are really distracted. So the question really remains that as distracted consumers, how can organizations reach out to these distracted consumers and make sure that they have embedded themselves in their minds? How can they create those little moments of customer loyalty that really bring alive the entire customer experience to them? So that's what I will be talking about today. We all know that experiences matter, no great news there. But what we'll basically be talking about is the fact that all consumers go through a number of experiences. Not all experiences are created equal, not all of them matter in the long run. The ones that matter actually affect your customer relationship and the relationship or the loyalty that you forge. That gives rise to a set of consumer behaviors that affect your relationship strength, and hence your business outcomes. So that, in a very short nutshell, is what I will talk about over the next 15-odd minutes. So think of your last restaurant visit. What would you remember? Would you remember the table setting, or would you remember the dessert? Obviously, no prizes for guessing. It would be the dessert. Think of your last movie visit. Would you really remember what the hall looked like when you walked in? Unless it was really dirty, then you would. But otherwise, not really. When you walk out, you would remember the movie that you just saw and whether it left an impression on you. Think of the last time you used your phone, probably still using, last few seconds ago. When you think of your phone or when you use your phone, you don't really think of the huge network that's out there in terms of the number of cell towers that enable you to make that connection. But you do remember the frustration of a dropped call, right? So the point that I'm trying to make is that people remember various things out of different experiences. And what is it that we actually remember? Frankly, do we remember the entire experience, or do we remember the memory of the experience? And that's a very critical distinction, because it is only those memories that stay with us that affect the customer relationship, right? We all know that our memories are flawed. And, you know, the fact is that what you think about today can change when you think about it in the future. So, yes, our memories are not factual representations of what we go through, but the fact remains that they are also our own truth. So what you remember is your truth as a consumer, right? So the point is that when there is an experience that a consumer goes through, what they remember will remain there to be their truth for times to come. So to give you a small example, think of a favorite childhood dish that you have. something that you really remember from your childhood. So for speaking from personal example, there was this one snack that I had had many years ago at an obscure railway station. Since then, I've had that snack many times in many different versions across a number of other places, but somehow the taste never matches up to what is there in my memory, right? So the point that I'm trying to emphasize is that what remains in your memory is what affects your relationship. So experiences create memories, and these memories really forge relationships, and it's the relationships or the memories of those which affect the entire business, relationship that you have with the brand and your business outcomes. But all are all experiences created equal? Like I said, do you remember everything about the past 24 hours, the last 1 month, the last 1 year? Not really. I don't think that 75% also looks like a small number to me. I don't think we remember anything less than more than 10% of what we've been through. Yeah. So the fact remains that not all experiences become memories. Also, the fact remains that not all experiences that you go through leave an impression on you. Yeah, if you look at the data here, what it says is that most consumers actually sleepwalk through experiences. If you look at the unaffected portion, which is the portion highlighted in pink, most consumers are actually sleepwalking through all experiences. If that is the case, how do you ensure that consumers remember the experience, remember you, and make it a part of their, and the, what they kind of, why should they choose you? So the answer, I think, is pretty simple. What do you actually remember? It's something that has an emotional connection with you, something that creates an emotional hook within you as a person. So yes, we are going online, we are going, you know, technologically savvy in a lot of things. We want to make hard decisions based on hard data, but at the end of the day, we are all human beings. It's something that needs to touch us somewhere deep inside. That's what we remember, right? So it's really the emotion that you leave the consumer with, whether it's a positive emotion or a negative emotion. Obviously, a positive emotion will give you a better payoff in terms of customer loyalty. A negative one will take away from it. So the point is that it is not really what you do for your customers. It is what customers feel when they go through the experience that they have with your organization. So let me give you another small example. A few years ago, we had to go by road for a family wedding from city A to city B. And the car that we owned that time was a Toyota. In the course of the journey at one point, we had an accident. So you can imagine how stressful the situation must have been. And obviously the car broke down, wouldn't move. To cut a long story short, we called the nearest Toyota service center. Those guys sent us a vehicle to pick all of us up and take us to the service center, sent a tow vehicle for the car. Once we reached the service center, we were made comfortable, given refreshments, given a place to relax, rest. They even finally gave us transport or arranged transport for us to get to the destination that we were going to. So as a consumer, if you put yourself in my shoes, what would you feel? You would feel that you've been taken care of, there's a sense of trust, and there's a fact that, you know, somebody is looking after you. So no prizes for guessing which my favorite car brand is. The next time I buy a car, obviously Toyota will be on top of my consideration set. So the point that I'm trying to make is the fact that it is these warm feelings or these sometimes these really disgusting feelings that have an impact on your customer relationships. So let's move into a bit of measurement now. Yes, we all know that we want to measure feelings and emotions, but how do we do that? 90 years ago, Freud said this, that it's difficult to deal with feelings. It still is, right? And everybody cannot deal with feelings on a, you know, on a very real-time basis or something that you can do very easily. So the way we look at this is that the loyalty metric that we use is a blend of both rational and emotional. Now, that's loyalty metrics across the board for you, whether it's an NPS or a metric that's used by anybody else. But the point really that I'm trying to make is the fact that there is obviously a rational component to it. So performance is table stakes. You cannot have a great relationship if you falter on performance itself. But what really sets you apart, what sets apart the great performers from the not so great performers is that they are able to create a strong customer preference for their brand or their product or their service. Yeah? And we will see later that how preference really trumps performance in terms of explaining the strength of relationships. I'll just take you through that. And the beauty of this is that it's borne out by different types of data, different types of small caselets that we've done. The fact is that preference monetizes beautifully. Customer who has given you a high preference score, or customers with high preferences, will be more likely to stay, will be more likely to spend more, and will be more likely to recommend. So your fabulous NPS metric should be going up if you have a customer who is feeling this way about you. So it's not necessary, or it's not just enough to perform well. You also need to translate that into into preference scores. So let's just look at a small example here. It has a bit of a similarity with what I went through. So this is a car repair workshop example. The data is from UK. If you look at the slide and you look at, let's say, the first column on the operational performance, you find that about 90% of the respondents are very happy with their, either very happy or they've given an excellent score for operational performance. But if you look at, and then if you look at the bottom part of it, which is like 11% only are unhappy with their repair performance. Now, after that, what happens is we ask, how do you feel after this experience? Now, there if we find that, so the first this thing to take away is that people who are negatively predisposed often feel bad about it, and that has a negative impact at an overall level. But let's move to those who said that it was an excellent performance. Even within those who've said that it was an excellent performance, not everybody is delighted, right? The point that I'm trying to make is that it is not just enough to get excellent on-service performance. It's also, you need to see what is the kind of feeling that you leave the consumer with. And the way that gets translated is if you look at the performance and preference scores. So the difference between those who've been enchanted, that is those who were delighted with the experience along with giving it a high score on performance, their preference is almost 30 points more than the people who were unaffected. So these are the guys who said that, yes, it was a fabulous performance, but it didn't do much for me. It didn't touch me anywhere. So the next question that begs an answer is that, okay, so then what is it that makes one enchanted, and what is it that makes one unaffected? So from this example, you can see that the guys who are unaffected, the reasons for their preference being low is very straightforward reasons, very rational reasons, right? So it was just that something got done well and there was no big deal. But the people who were really delighted, and all the reasons, as you can see, were to do with quality of people, yeah? So really, it's the human touch that makes a lot of the difference. Now, that was as far as the touch point itself was concerned. Now, let's see if it has an impact on the overall relationship strength. If you look at the chart in gray on the side, what we've done here is tried to correlate the different brands of car makes with the performance scores and with the relationship strength. So it has a pretty solid correlation of about 0.59, which is like to say that 60% of your relationship strength can be explained by the repair shop performance. But if you look at the slide on the figure on the left in pink, which talks about the emotion score, that is how do you feel after that experience, the R-square there jumps up by almost 50%. And that's a solid R-square of 0.8. I don't think you can get better R-squares than that. So that's the proof of the pudding that if your trim scores, if your emotion scores are high, they correlate much better with the strength of relationship. I have some more case studies across different industries and different touch points, but the point is really the same, and I don't think there's any difference that we are going to see in some of the numbers. Just to sort of bring home the point that even if it's an excellent performance at a overall level, how do you really engage customers? How do you make them feel at the end of the transaction that you get higher preference scores, which translates into better business outcomes? Yeah. So that's an example from a retail banking scenario. And in this context, recently I heard about a colleague who had this great experience with a credit card company here in Malaysia. There was a fraudulent charge on her card, and she got a proactive call from the bank saying that we've noticed this transaction on your card, which seems to be coming from China, and you don't have to worry about it. We'll take care of it. We'll send you a new card. We've canceled your card, and these charges will be reversed. So there's really nothing that you need to do. So you can imagine that she was so excited. She was so happy with the entire experience, and she's not going to be able to, she's not going to change her service provider for that credit card for some time to come. So it's really these small kind of things that, you know, make the difference between having a delighted customer or a completely unaffected one. And again, to show you some correlation scores for US and UK, similarly for strength of retail banking relationships, we find that the R-squares are again very high with the trim emotion score. So that was US and UK. Let's look at Malaysia. Are we the same? And I'd like people from the audience to share any examples of great or lousy customer experience that they would have had. I'm sure the call center is a place that many of us call into many times. We may have fraudulent charges on the card or something that you don't agree with. And the way you are dealt with really makes all the difference between being delighted and being totally enchanted with the experience or being absolutely unaffected with it. So any examples that anybody would like to share? Okay, I think people need coffee. So that's the case study of a service point. Again, similar examples. What I'd just like you to notice once more is that the inbound call center, the excellence score is 39, and the service point, the excellence score is 44. These are all some kind of human touch, human-led touch points. But if you look at an online portal, there your excellence score is much less. Obviously, the capacity to delight a customer from a technology perspective is obviously lower. So yeah, that difference you can see. But yes, having said that, if you do manage to delight the customer, if they are able to complete their work and hassle-free, then you do get better preference scores compared to those who have been unaffected by it. So the question then begs itself as to what is it that you need to measure? Should you measure experience or should you measure memory? What we just went through is the fact that the trim emotion score, which is based on the memory, has a much greater and a much better impact on your overall strength of relationship. So maybe it's not a bad idea to actually let those transactions rest for a mind in the minds of your consumers and not really sample them straight away after the interaction. So wait for a little time. I'm not saying that wait for ages, but yes, wait for a little time before you can get an understanding of how customers feel about those experiences. So in a nutshell, what are we saying? That performance matters. Definitely it does. It's table stakes. You can't run away from it, but it's not enough. Yeah? Emotional imprinting is the one that you need to embed yourselves in the minds of consumers in all those little moments that make or break your relationship. Preference trumps performance, and that I've shown you a lot of numbers which tell you that. Preference leads to stronger relationships. And the downside is that if it is a bad experience, then it will have a very, you know, almost like a linear backlash. So you need to make sure that your bad experiences should be minimized to the extent possible. One thing that I've seen clients across the board kind of struggle with is the fact that there do seem to be pockets of excellence, islands of excellence across all organizations, which is the reason that you have customers who are delighted at some point or the other. But the challenge is really to be able to deliver that consistently across a wide variety of experiences across all types of customers. And I think that is the bigger challenge, more than just, you know, thinking about whether that experience is going well or not. So it's the consistency of the experience also that matters. So the question that I'll leave you with, which you need to answer for yourselves, is how do you think your customers feel after their last transaction with you? Thank you.